first step would be to acknowledge the fact that you don't feel good about it. You know, that inner voice, that gut feeling, it's your intuition. And I think people should believe in themselves and people should believe.
So what did you actually learn? Because when, you know, you're an MBA, we do a lot of case studies. We study how businesses have started, what strategies to apply. But when you go on ground and even to, you know, set up something which might seem as small as a Pani Puri shop, how much effort did it take you? And what were those learnings?
Okay, so I think the biggest learning that has been because of Sweet and Spice has been people skills. So how to handle people, how to talk to people, because our bhaiya, the way we were able to land somebody in the first place, the way we were able to get our first employee was because he was very impressed by our demeanor, because we were very polite and he thought that we would make good employers. That is why he chose to quit whatever he was doing outside and come here and be there for us. And then we got like more people on board and it happened almost exactly in the same way. So I'll tell you what happened. So we had our bhaiya, the employee. So we used to like talk in a very courteous manner to him. He was elder than us, so naturally we were courteous all the time. So word spread around the campus that we are really good employers, like we talk very nicely and we don't subject people to overtime or something like that. So word spread around the campus, and another person who was already working in the campus for another food venture, they came to us and said, we want to work for you and I really want to leave that job. So we were like, okay, but is that okay with them? Like,
yeah.
So we sorted everything out. Turns out they were anyways going to hire somebody else. So that bhaiya also came on board with us, and that is what helped us diversify. That, because he came with a really good skill set. And he was an expert in making certain dishes. So that's how we started diversifying our menu into different dishes. And then we became profitable when we diversified and did all of that. Also, that bhaiya, he brought his team along with us. So he brought like two people along with us. So he brought two people along with him. And they were all very good at what they did. So our product became very famous. Like, I'll tell you, our falafel roll became very famous, like the campus favorite. So another lesson that I derived was, if you have a good product, that can take you places. If your product is not good enough or strong, then any amount of marketing or sales initiatives will not work. So we did some marketing. We did collaborate with a lot of student organizations, and we distributed vouchers and coupons to winners of certain competitions. So we did some PR campaigns, and we used to do email marketing a lot. But at the end of the day, our product was really good, and that is what drew people to our shop. So that's another very valuable lesson that I derived. One was people skills, and other was product.
Yeah. Aradhya, you have mentioned a very good point, and I would say, you know, I was having a discussion with someone about this also, that no matter how much of marketing you do, how much good your team is at marketing, if your marketing or sales can bring the customer to the shop, but if he doesn't like the product, no matter what you do, he'll not come back or she'll not come back. Because your core product is your actual offering. These are just add-ons, your marketing, your sales and everything. So if that is good, it spreads by words. You know, log khud hi baat karne lag jate ki haan bahut acha hai. Jaise you hired that another bhaiya because he loved that you were, you know, you would make a very good employer. So now moving on to the next question, while being in, you know, IIM Indore, you were also associated with a lot of committees. You have mentioned that being someone who is good in public speaking, you have also trained almost 1,000 students. So tell us about that part.
Okay, yeah. So actually that 1,000 student training part is separate from IIM Indore.
Okay.
I'll talk about the committees first and then we'll move on to that initiative.
Sure.
Actually, more than committees, I like working for college fests. The reason is because there is more action, more excitement, and you really need to get things done. For that fest to happen, you have to get things off the ground. So there is a lot of work that goes in the fest, goes in conducting a fest, and there is very little scope for slacking off or anything. There has to be sincere effort from everybody to make a fest happen. Whereas in committees, it's not actually, committees are not that action oriented. I mean, there can be a year when one committee is not very active. It is possible. But for a fest, the team has to be really active and really passionate to get things going. So mostly I was into sponsorship and events. And I had a really good time. I mean, I have a lot of stories from there and I will try and pick some stories and tell you as we go along the way. Coming on that initiative of training students. So as I mentioned earlier, I was good at debating when I was in school and public speaking in general. So even after I graduated school, my principal used to call me that whenever, she used to say that, Aradhya, whenever you're in Kanpur, please do come visit the school and take a session or two for the kids. So I used to do that a lot. Whenever I was at home for my semester break and the school was open, I used to go and ma'am used to arrange for classes or lectures or something. And I used to give public speaking tips. And at one point, they also asked me to give some career counseling tips. So I used to give that also. Yeah, and so this went on for almost all my college life, all 5 years. And now that I have graduated, and as we know, right now we are living in a pandemic situation and everything's under lockdown. But the schools are still going on. Everything has shifted online. But there are still competitions, declamations and all that are taking place. So actually, my joining got delayed. So I haven't still joined the workforce. So I was free, I was sitting at home. So I just had a chat with my teachers and principal ma'am. And I said that if you need any help mentoring students for declamations or something, just let me know, I can take classes. So they were very happy and they allowed me to do that. And so that's how it happened. So I used to train students of class 6th, 7th, 8th and 9th. In public speaking and in declamation. So that's how it happened. It went on for like 2 months roughly, I guess May and June was that time.
And this you did because your joining was delayed, so utilizing that amount of time that you had. So I'll take you back to your actually being in college. So one thing that I can understand, you know, Aradhya, through this interview is you're a very organized person who strategizes really well. So now, one another thing that happened while you were in college was that you interned with Google. So how did you make that strategy of cracking the interview?
Oh my God. Okay, so no great strategy, but I'll tell you. So Google comes to our campus for summer placements and I applied like all other kids from my batch. So we had written exam and online exam, of course, like an aptitude test.
Right.
And after that, so they took the scores of the aptitude test and the resume into consideration. So both of them combined, and then they released a shortlist. So thankfully, I got shortlisted for one of the roles. It was product marketing. And then after the shortlisting, there were three interviews. one was on telephone and two others were on Google Hangouts. So yeah, Google Meet. And So Google is very helpful, as in they provide you with a lot of material to prepare for the interview. So they sent across a lot of documents to me that I could study. Plus, they also had a webinar on how to crack a Google interview. It's still available on YouTube. So for people who are listening to this and are interested in preparing for a Google interview, there is a webinar on YouTube taken by Google HRs. So that was there. So I read all of that. I went through the webinar and everything. And I also read a lot of news that was there about Google, all the recent happenings that had taken place. Since the internship was in product marketing, I thought I should know about Google products. Right. Once I started studying the products, I mean, the list is so long. I mean, we think we know about Google products, but
Exactly. Actually
there's a fair chance we might not know about a lot of products. So once I started studying about the products, I mean, it took up the whole time and I was not able to complete all of that. So I went in thinking that I'm not prepared. I'm not well prepared for this. But what actually happened was during the interviews, so this is all public knowledge. They have hypothetical and behavioral questions where they put you in situations and ask, what will you do if this happens? How will you react? Or they give you, or they ask you questions in which you have to use examples from your life that when so-and-so happened, when I was in college, how did I deal with it? So these sort of questions are there. So whenever they put me in some situation and ask me, what will you do if you were in such a situation? I already had a example of the exact same situation I had been in before. So I said, So I have actually experienced this. I'll tell you what happened. And then I used to explain. So almost for every situation that they put me in, I had like real life examples to explain to them that this is what happened and then this is what I did. So the interview went very like way beyond my expectations. It went really well and okay. I got in, so that made me really happy.
And how was the experience, you know, interning with Google? Because it's, you know, one of the most prestigious organizations in the world to work for, not only in India. So how was that experience?
It was absolutely wonderful. Everything that you have heard about Google, that it is the best place to work for and everything is true. They deserve it, because they really treat you very well. They give you a lot of autonomy. Being an intern, I was given so much autonomy. I took projects on my own. I went beyond the scope of the internship to do things. And not just and I worked not just with the marketing vertical where I was interning, but I worked with four other verticals to finish some projects that I started. And I started them because I felt this needed to be done, and I just ran it across my my reporting manager, and he said, yeah, sure, if you feel this is a good thing to do, then why not, go ahead. Like, he gave me complete autonomy, so that was really great. And my time at Google was absolutely wonderful, and I did get an interview offer as well for their full-time joining, but that's another story. That interview didn't go very well, so that's why I didn't get to join Google. Yeah.
That's okay. But and now you will be joining PwC as consultant, right?
Yeah.
So, you know, when we talk about your achievements, Aradhya, there are too many, actually, to be frank, and I'll have to actually look into my mobile to read them out to the people reading it. You are IIM Indore Gold Medal for Scholastic Performance Rank 1. IIM Indore Gold Medal for the Best Women Participant for Scholastic Performance. IPM Gold Medal for Best All-Rounder Performer Female, Certificate of Academic Excellence, Women Entrepreneurship Award, Times of India Student of the Year Award. And there are many more which I have not even read, because it will take a lot of time for this interview. How do you manage, you know, to... It's okay if people achieve one thing, then they achieve the second thing. But what, you know, actually makes you keep pushing for more, keep pushing for more? Because it is clearly evident, you know, when I'm having a conversation with you, that you want to make an impact. You want to make sure that whenever you have time, you are doing something, you know, which is valuable, which is adding value, just not only occupying time, but also adding value, like you mentored children when there was a gap between your joining. So my question is, what motivates you, or what is your thought process of moving from one achievement to the other?
Okay. See, my thought process is, as you rightly mentioned, I really want to do something that has an impact. And to be very frank, I mean, I am very happy with all that I have got, with the support of my parents, and by God's grace, all that I have achieved till now. I'm very grateful for that. But honestly, I don't think, I feel I have a long way to go. I have not even begun my career yet. Being from IIM Indore might have given me a pole position, but I feel I'm still at the starting line, and there is a long way to go, a long career that lies ahead of me, and a lot of things that I can do in future. I mean, the things that I have done till now, they might have had impact. That was the aim, to have a positive impact. But I think it's not enough. There is so much to be done. I mean, yeah, there is a long way to go. I feel that I still have a lot to learn. I still feel I'm a very naive 23-year-old individual, and there is so much to be done in life. So I don't regard
me. You are actually too humble to accept your, I'll say, achievements. So you know, Aradhya, there are a lot of people who know, people who try for, let's say, IIT, who try for IAS, who try for getting into defense forces, who try to get into their dream companies, but not all of them are actually not all of them actually want to do it. Most of the time it is that their parents are taking a decision for them, their relatives are taking a decision for them. In your case, you being a very bright child who loved studying, who scored really well, and then came a time where when IIT happened, you became an average student, suddenly your confidence was lost, and then you rediscovered it in, let's say, IIM Indore. Now, what advice or what suggestion would you want to give to those students who are going through this phase right now? Somebody right now might be preparing for IIT just because his parents have forced him or her, or just because of the relatives, or any other, let's say, exam for that matter. And, you know, he's finding it difficult to tell to his parents or come accept the reality that this is something that he or she doesn't want to do. So for them, what do you want to say?
Okay, so what I want to say is that our parents, our family, teachers, and everybody who tell us to do something, they do it, they tell us so because they think that is the best way for us. They think that will lead us to a safe, secure life, and that will give us everything we want in life. But if we know that this is not the way for us and we feel it, the first step is to acknowledge that feeling that, okay, I don't feel good about this. This is not me. I am not liking doing this. So first step is to acknowledge that feeling inside you. The first step would be to acknowledge the fact that you don't feel good about it. You know, that inner voice, that gut feeling, it's your intuition. And I think people should believe in themselves, and people should believe in their intuitions when, you know, they feel like this is something wrong, this is not the way to go. I think they should pay heed to that inner voice. So that's the first step. Then, as I said, that your parents and everybody around you thinks that this will lead you to a better life, this will get you whatever you want, and this is the way to a safe and secure life. But the truth is that if you have chosen a path and you are not able to excel in that path, then it might not lead you to those heights of success and prosperity that your family and you are imagining for yourself. So the key is excellence. Choose something you can excel in that will give you happiness, and that will eventually take you where your family wants to see you, you know, at the heights of success and prosperity. Exactly. So yeah, So the key is excellence. And if you feel you cannot excel in that path where you are being pushed or where you yourself are going, it's high time to, you know, introspect a little. Just, you know, try to see within yourself, spend some time with yourself and take a call and explain that to your family, to your friends, teachers, whoever it is around you. Explain to them that if I go this way, I might not be one of the best. This is not what I want to do. I don't feel good while doing it, and it is not going to take me anywhere as it is. So let me do something that I feel I'll be good at, so that there is some scope to excel there and make a name for myself and give you all satisfaction and give you all a comfortable life. In the end, we are the social security for our parents, our family. It is we who take care of them when they get old, and when we become independent, we start taking care of them. So if we don't get ourselves in a good place, how will we be able to take care of them? So that's a way to explain to them that you know what, if I go this way where I feel I'll do good and I'll excel, it will be better for me also. I'll be a happier person, I'll be more satisfied, and I'll be able to take care of you in a better way, and that will make all of us happy. So
exactly. Just adding to your point, and even to parents, you know, through this interview, when it goes live, when parents will be seeing it, your parents would be seeing it, my parents would be seeing it, and a lot of people will see it. Parents always want, you know, good for their child. There is absolutely no doubt in that. But what they have to understand is that every child wants to be successful. But the definition of success is different for different people. Not everybody wants to be IIT, JEE or IAS or get into MBA. Some people want to be musician, cricketers. So now is the time when we, you know, actually allow the child to express themselves, ask them what they want to do, because the ultimate aim is to get successful, you know. But what happens is that only when you are academically good, you are being treated well, you know, you are seeing that you are going to do very well in life. Even if you're not doing academically well, a child has to be asked, okay, what he or she is interested in, so that he doesn't feel, you know, that just because I cannot do good at studies or one particular thing, I'm less than any other person.
Exactly, yeah.
So, you know, Aradhya, with this, we have almost come to the end of the interview. I'll ask you last two questions. So during your preparation times or during in your life in general, who is the inspiration that you look up to?
Wow. Okay. So I have some role models in my family and some role models outside my family. So okay. In my family, it's my mother. And because she is the epitome of sacrifice. She has sacrificed a lot for us, and she did it all with a smile. So, and she's very humble, very she doesn't want a lot of materialistic things, and she's very I think a very strong person spiritually, as well as as I said, she is very humble, and she sacrificed a lot for us. And outside my family, my role models, I have two role models, and there is a short story over here. So my two role models are Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam and Dr. Stephen Hawking. I really am inspired by Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam because he was from a very poor background. We can say he was externally disadvantaged, as in he was not endowed upon with a lot of materialistic wealth and privilege, but still he managed to rise to such heights. I'm inspired by Dr. Stephen Hawking because he battled something that was not external but internal. So he had an internal affliction. His health was not always the best, but still he managed to do what he did, and all of us admire and get inspired from him every day. So these are all my role models in life.
That's wonderful to hear, Aradhya. Now, the last concluding question. So now, what is Aradhya's aim? Now, what is the purpose?
Okay. So now that I'm standing at the cusp of, you know, beginning another journey, I'm on the verge of starting my professional career. All I want is to be, you know, to be good at whatever I do, to like my work, to have the good fortune of liking what I do. And to be very honest, I really, as I mentioned before, I have always wanted to do something that has a lot of impact on a lot of lives. And I believe the career that I have chosen and the path where I am going will help me in doing that. So I just really wish that everything happens accordingly, and I am able to make some tangible difference in the lives of other people and in my life as well. Yeah.
And we strongly at Speak PGR, we believe that you are going to do wonders in life. You know, 5 years down the lane, or let's say 10 years down the lane, we would be seeing Aradhya doing something which has actually changed the world. And the reason why, you know, Aradhya, right now, if you see, because being an MBA student and understanding how actually marketing works, now is a time where people want a 30-second video, a 60-second video to catch their attraction. That is a time when we are starting with something where we are doing comprehensive interviews, because we understand that, you know, the journey has taken so much of time. Even 1 hour is actually not enough to capture everything. We have only captured the highlights. And that is why we thought of doing a detailed interview, and you have an amazing journey. You know, a lot of people who are going to see this interview, and our aim is that even if one person gets inspired from this and he or she decides, okay, I know someone who struggled, but she fought back, she did what she wanted to do, and now she has excelled in her life. So I am also going to do the same. If through this interview, even one person can think of you as your role model and, you know, make a change in his or her life, our job would be done, because that's the motive, you know, with which we have started this platform. So I would like to say thank you so much for coming. It really means a lot that you gave us time and came on this platform. So thank you so much.
No, it's the pleasure is all mine, and it's an honor for me to be here and reach out to so many people with my story, all thanks to you. So thank you for starting initiatives like this. It's really needed, as in we really need more such initiatives like Speak with GRV. So thank you so much for giving me this chance, having me here, and thank you so much to all the listeners if you gave your time to listen to this interview. Thank you so much.